Hey guys, welcome to round one. We are paired against a random drooler here, we're also keeping this on the play. Hand seems pretty solid. Remember that our curb goes up to five, so the fourth land isn't even that out of line. We're gonna need a fifth if we want to combo off with Kiki Cheeky. I like this. I like both of these. You on top, you after. Yeah, that's a great curve. We can go turn two, Wall of Omens, and then turn three, play some removal spell or other, and turn four, Resto, Blink the Wall. Restoration Angel, pretty good. Oh shit. pardon me. Pardon my French there. Oh shoot. Yeah. So Faithless Looting implies Agorio's Vengeance deck, which means that we might not even be able to play the wall this turn. We might have to hold up Path to Exile. Which doesn't do anything. Yeah, there's a Grizzlebrand. Yeah, Path doesn't do anything against Emrakul, but it does stop him from hitting me with Grizzlebrand. So if he reanimates it and pays like 14 life, goes to attack, we Path. Then he's like kind of close to getting burned out. Night's Whisper, that's what I like to see. Now here we're holding up both Path to Exile and Lightning Bolt with the fetch, which is pretty key. Because if we don't end up pathing Grizzlebrand here, we definitely want to bolt his face, put him down to 15. And that'll restrict him to only being able to draw 7 cards off of a potential Grizzlebrand, because otherwise we'd be able to electrolyze him out. It just starts to get very, very dicey for him, very touch and go. Pardon me. Flashing back, Faithless Looting. That's a great sign. Yeah, either his hand is all like through the breach nonsense, or I mean, if he had a Agorio's Vengeance, he'd probably go for it. So you have to imagine he's digging for that. Yeah, either digging for fast mana to cast through the breach. Okay, he is playing the Nourishing Shoal version. I think I want Sacred Foundry here. So that's pretty dangerous because it means that he can just combo us at instant speed because he's playing the Nourishing Shoal version. It means I don't think they run Emrakul, so there's that. I haven't faced this deck in a minute. They almost always kill by getting back Grizzlebrand, gaining some life, that sort of thing. So I'm actually not sure if I played this Resto here or not, because I'm not holding up mana that way. I think I actually just cycled the Electrolyze. It seems a little counterintuitive, but being able to path a Grizzlebrand in response to a draw 7 or whatever seems pretty important. And taking one turn off of attacking with Resto is probably not going to break me this game. I think it's going to come down to other factors. Okay, that resolved. Deceiver, interesting. Looks like he's going for an end of turn through the breach here. Wonder why he'd fire off the Desperate Ritual. Oh, he's splicing Goryeo's Vengeance onto it. Okay. I think I just path that thing. As opposed to Deceiver Tapping. Deceiver Tapping could be good too. The nice thing about pathing is if he tries to draw seven, we can snap Bolt in response. Because he's at 10 life here. Just lets that resolve. Goes for Night's Whisper. I think I'm gonna fetch out like a mountain or something and go in for the end of turn resto this time. It's a little bit different than last time. Because he doesn't have a Grizzlebrand in the graveyard. So like if I go end of turn resto and he in response gets a Borborygmos or whatever, that's probably fine. It's probably not going to kill us. And he's also burned a little bit of fast mana between the Simeon Spirit Guide and the Desperate Ritual. I guess we know that he has the Goryeo's Vengeance in hand. I don't think that changes anything, though. Like, this isn't going to kill us. If he Goryeo's Vengeance is the Borborygmos on his own end of turn, he's not going to get to attack with it. It'll just be up during our turn. He'll be able to kill the resto. He might be able to deal me some damage. But overall, I don't think it's that scary. In response to the resto, he Nourishing Shoals. Okay. And he's up to 19. He was just worried about the Nourishing Shoal getting countered, I think. His life total was a little bit precarious there. So he must have drawn into either the World Spine Worm or the Nourishing Shoal off of the Night's Whisper, because he definitely didn't have it when I went to path this guy, or he would have gained some life in response to see if he could draw some cards. So odds are he doesn't have a second Nourishing Shoal hanging out. He could, of course, draw into one. Like, it's not like... Yeah, I kind of wish this Deceiver Exarch was like a Bolt or something. In this game. I'm not sure if I should run the Resto out. I could go Deceiver, untap land, play Resto. I really don't think that's worth it, though. Because the Deceiver... Like, the tap ability could actually be useful if he's trying to get an attack in with Grizzlebrand, which could come up. If I go end of turn Resto Angel, and he decides that that's his moment to go for it at instant speed, when I only have two mana up, then that's pretty awkward, because then I can't snapcast back path or anything like that. So I could see him doing that if he had, like, a Simeon Spirit Guide in hand. Like, if he bends Grizzlebrand off this Faithless Looting and then just passes, and we go end of turn Resto, and he's sitting there with Simeon Spirit Guide in hand, then he kind of thinks, okay, if my opponent has Mana Leak, I can pitch the Simeon Spirit Guide, pay for it, and kill him. And if he has Remand, I'll just recast the Gorgo's Vengeance. So because I would only have two mana up... Oh my god, please Gorgo's Vengeance that Emrakul. That would be the best. Oh, he's splicing the Gorgo's Vengeance onto the Nourishing Shoal. So this is going to be pretty awesome. He resets his graveyard, which had a few Faithless Lootings in it, as well as a Bobrigmos that... And we do this. Might be a little surprising to the opponent here. And I don't think we Snapcast back Bolt. I think we want to hold on to the Snapcaster for Path. Because that could be a very real thing. Emrakul the Aeon's Torrent has entered the exiled zone. Opponent's down to two cards in hand. He has plenty of life to work with, just not very many cards. So the only concern here with end of turn Restoing is that he might have Through the Breach Grizzlebrand, pretty specifically. I think I can get away with this. I guess the Resto was an answer to Emrakul again, because we could blink the Deceiver, but we're also at 16 life and we have plenty of permanents, so it's not like Emrakul was game ending regardless. So what's the clock look like? If we tag him for 7, he drops down to 16. And then we go Bolt, Snap, Bolt. There's another 6 down to 10. And then we're attacking for plenty. So it's not like activating Colonnade here speeds up our clock at all. Yeah, so it's whether or not he can reanimate or Through the Breach in something for a third time this turn, because he's already done that twice. He's already made a Grizzlebrand and an Emrakul. Oh, do we get back Electrolyze? 6, 7, 11 plus 2 is 13. By itself, yeah, I think I get back Electrolyze as opposed to Bolt here. I don't think it matters. So the only concern here is if he was sitting on Through the Breach, but that wouldn't make too much sense unless it was Through the Breach Emrakul, because we had plenty of permanents to sacrifice. And in that case, Through the Breaching... Well, yeah, I guess I could see sitting on it regardless. Definitely want these counter spells, probably all of them. Counterflux is a little bit slow. I don't think I want Celestial Purge. Seems worse than like a Path or something. This seems solid. The Snapcasters are obviously pretty bad if I get a Rest in Peace down. Like, they just turn into 2/1s, but the nice thing about Rest in Peace is that it kind of makes his whole deck negligible, so... So that seems like a fine trade-off. And then if he ever answers the Rest in Peace, then the Snapcasters can still get back counter spells. And if I don't draw the Rest in Peace, they're going to be Snapcasting back Dispel, Remand, Path to Exile, just like we saw that game. And it's not like any of these cards in my sideboard are better at all. Yeah, this is pretty much exactly the sort of hand that you don't want to see. Like, the Serum Visions are tempting because it means that you have a really good chance of smoothing out your draws and everything. The problem is that we don't actually have any disruption, and you kind of need disruption in this matchup. You need, like, a Dispel or a Negate or something, and this hand just doesn't have any of that. Dispel is a really good card in this matchup. So because we don't actually, because we need both, like, land drops and disruption off the top, it's just asking a little bit too much out of the top card of our library, so. Okay. Not thrilled about this, but I guess we'll see. Yep, gonna bottom that. Okay. Blood Crypt into play tapped, that's a good sign. No, like, turn one Faithless Looting, then Grizzlebrand, that would have been scary. Turn two Night's Whisper, I can get behind this. Didn't we just bottom a Kiki-Jiki? So we've seen all of them. So he's got a turn here where we're not holding up Negate, which is kind of a bummer on our end, but it's worth it to get the Jace in play. There's always that risk to reward. Oh my god. Please don't kill me. Please don't kill me. Please don't kill me. I said please. No, you can't kill me. No, or he can. He can, in fact, still kill me. Despite the fact that I asked him very nicely, it would just make him rude, is all. That's all I'm saying. Rude dude in a crude mood. What am I talking about? Okay, so the looting... Let's see, he was on the play, so he can still make a land drop. So he actually just needs Grizzlebrand plus Goryeo's Vengeance. And if he wants to fire off Emrakul here, like if, say if he draws an Emrakul off the Faithless Looting, then he would need a Simeon Spirit Guide. Well, he just discarded a Goryeo's Vengeance and a Grizzlebrand. So that is a bad sign for the home team. Yeah, maybe we should have just held up Negate. One problem that I have with holding up Negate for forever is that your opponent can also just play like an Inquisition of Kozilek against you or whatever. And getting Jace in play is pretty important when you look at our hand. Like, there's a chance that we hold up Negate and he just kills us anyway because he has Pact or whatever. So I think being able to either find more disruption or find pressure is pretty important. All right. Opponent decides to attack. It's a pretty solid line there. Serve with my 7/7 lifelinker. Now, one nice thing about this deck, as opposed to like the Grixis Reanimator deck with Izzet Charms or whatever, is that you fizzle way less often, like because any Nourishing Shoal is going to let you just dig into the rest of your deck. There's only so many times you can draw 7 cards and not hit, you know what I mean? And so pretty much all the time that you fire off a turn 2 Goryeo's Vengeance like this, you're going to combo. You're gonna draw your whole deck. And he drew down to 4 life again. One version of that deck, and if you've watched my videos for a long time, you might remember this, but one version of this deck that I liked a lot was the straight red-black version. And then I also played cards like Blood Moon in the main deck. So I could turn two Blood Moon people off of Simeon Spirit Guide, that sort of thing. Just splice a Desperate Ritual onto a Nourishing Shoal. That's pretty cute. And there's another one. And another splice. Just casts the ritual. I guess he's through the Breaching in Borborygmos here. And he can just discard lands until we're dead. GG. Both sides played hard, man. Yeah, I'm just gonna submit this and hope it goes a little bit better than last time. Oh, Jayway is in our 8-man. That's interesting. Jayway saw a little bit of internet fame when he was winning dailies and such with a 65-card scapeshift deck. And he was doing it so that he had enough slots so that he could have basically enough like natural mountains. I think this was an old extended. And people were playing the 2-man enchantment that turned all of your lands into all types. And so he wanted to have enough actual mountains in his deck so that he could scape shift without having one in play. He still wanted to play that card so that he could combo off with only 7 lands or whatever it was, just like be a little bit quicker, a little bit more consistent. But he still wanted to have access to the mountains in his deck in case he didn't have the enchantment in play. So it certainly turned some heads at the time. On the play in game 3, yeah, this hand seems great. This needs to get a Hollowed Fountain. I played him the other day, and he was playing that Ad Nauseam deck. Jayway was. Oh, crap. Okay. Not the stock version of Ad Nauseam, but he was playing a bunch of artifacts. And, so he like the zero mana artifacts like Mishra's Bauble, Mox Opal, that sort of thing. So he could fire off an Ad Nauseam and draw through most of his deck, which was pretty cute. And then Mox Opal replaces Simeon Spirit Guide, so you have access to red mana after you've drawn your whole deck. Anyway. Well, I want to fire off this Serum Visions here, which I believe means that I discard either the Jace or the Colonnade. I'm going to discard Jace. I actually think we might tap out for Wall of Omens too. Because the Dispel isn't actually answering him. Because of the Boseiju. Okay, yeah, I'm gonna bottom that. I'm gonna keep the path on top. Fire this off. Pardon the dog in the background. Anamorphose. I guess that's one that I could have dispelled or remanded. Metamorphosed into nothing. That's what I like to see. Seems great. Kiki jiki. Redundant path. I think I should discard one of these paths. Oh, one nice thing is if he needs to ritual into Through the Breach, then that's not really something he has the luxury of doing. Because we can counter either the ritual or the Through the Breach, whichever he doesn't protect with a Besieger. Okay, my opponent's passing. I don't think we fire off the Electrolyze. I want to have it like at least Dispel slash Path up. So he slow discards Grizzlebrand. We could cast Kiki Jiki here, but that would be kind of suicidal, I think. He's had a lot of time to set up. I kind of like looting away the Electrolyze and then flashing back Serum Visions. We just dig a little bit deeper that way. Yeah, I still like binning the Electrolyze. Although now I'm not sure about flashing back Serum Visions. Because the mana might actually be necessary. It's worth thinking about here. Like, going path, snapcast back, path, dispel. Or snapcast back, dispel, you know. It's kind of borderline. I'm going to flash back the Serum Visions, but I'm not absolutely sure that it's correct. Yep, still looking for either a Resto or a Deceiver. Deceiver would be great, because it would also mean that he wouldn't be able to combo us with Emrakul like we would. Okay. So we paid the life for Goryeo's Vengeance. So I'm going to set a stop on my end of turn. And just path this now. I guess then he gets the land that way. So I guess I'll set the stop on his upkeep. I mean, he gets to use the land on his next turn if I path him now. Which might be helpful if he's trying to Through the Breach. Yeah, that does seem... like it's a useful thing. Okay, so upkeep, path. He chooses to draw in response to the Grizzlebrand. Makes sense. It's going to be real hard to win this one. Because even if he just like makes an Emrakul, like we almost have to throw out the Snapcaster just to sacrifice to Annihilator. We sacrifice Jace, Snapcaster, Wall of Omens, and then we still need to sacrifice three more permanents. So we would go down to two permanents, and then we'd probably just die to whatever it is that he's doing. Rough stuff. Oh, hey, Nourishing Shoal. That's one we can actually counter. And I will. I will counter that. I guess with Dispel. Kind of tips my hand that I'm not holding a path anymore, but oh well. Yeah, so Besieger not being able to protect Nourishing Shoal might actually be pretty relevant, depending on his draws. Okay, the counter on the Nourishing Shoal resolved, and the path resolved. This could be good for me. I imagine this is good for me. He didn't want to draw another seven there, which means that he either feels like he has the game locked up already, or he feels like he just doesn't want to take that much damage. Yeah, there's the Simian Spirit Guide. He's making something uncounterable. Looks like a Through the Breach. Hopefully not for Imrakul. Alright, that's going to resolve. World Spined Worm. Can we beat 3 15-15s? I don't know. I don't even... I don't know if that's a thing I can beat. So we're down to 4. World Spine Worm sacrifices, gets shuffled into the library, generates some 5/5s. What's our best draw? Probably that Deceiver Exarch. Though I don't think it saves us. But it's close, and it's real close. We need 3 mana to snap cast back a path on one of the worm tokens. If we had 7 mana right now, we could actually just combo. We could go Deceiver Exarch, untap a land, Kiki Jiki. We don't have that though. Okay, so Jace can shrink a worm. And then Deceiver Exarch can tap a worm and block the worm that was shrunk, and Wall of Omens can go in front of another worm. Which would have me taking 1 damage and going to 3. And then we would have Negate up for a Lightning Bolt, I guess. Yeah, this game is actually kind of intense. I'm pretty sure I just want to go Deceiver Exarch, tap down a worm. It gives him an opportunity if he's slow rolling, like Through the Breach Emrakul. It gives him an opportunity to do that. I'm thinking about negating the Faithless Looting. What if he has Pact of Negation and we need to, like, counter a pact on the Deceiver Exarch? Encountering this Faithless Looting could be really bad. But if he's binning either an Emrakul or a Grizzlebrand, it could be really good. Yeah, I don't know. I think it's pretty borderline, but the fact that the Besiege You kind of limits the cards that we can counter means that I think I should be countering what I can here. We don't know if he has Pact post-board. If he'd had it, he might have used it during the counter war over like the Nourishing Shoal and stuff the other turn. Maybe he had it and he just didn't think it was worth fighting over because he knew he could make some worms. In which case, a Pact of Negation here would be game-winning when we go for the Deceiver Exarch, tapping a worm or whatever. I think think he's considering whether he wants to flash back to Faithless Looting. Alright. Well, let's see if this can resolve. If it resolves, and he doesn't, like, kill me or whatever, then we might pull this game off. Yeah, Slaughter Pact here wins for him, like any kind of removal spell wins. He's sitting there with 7 cards in his hand, so you have to kind of wonder, like, what are those 7 cards? On the other hand, I have played that deck before. You can certainly be staring at a pile of, like, Emrakuls or Through the Breaches or whatever, and just, like, not have the other half of the combo, just have a bunch of lands. I don't think he would have Lightning Bolt in post-board against me. I think you have to board that sort of thing out for cards like discard spells and whatnot. I don't think Bolt just kills enough. Oh, he's making something uncounterable. That was a boil. It's a good thing we drew a land. It's so good that we drew a land there. That's insane. It's also a good thing that we run basic islands, and it's an incredible thing that we just happen to have a Cascade Bluffs in play. So the only thing that could win here is a pact, and he doesn't appear to have it. Okay, and there's the concession. Crazy. That was a crazy match to win. I didn't think we were winning that third game after I saw the Besiege you enter play, but we navigated it. And in game one, he reanimated a few times too, and we won despite that. So yeah, lots of fun, pretty intricate match. On to round two, I'll see you guys there.